So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Isha. I'm the External Relations Secretary for IIM Calcutta. I have with me Rikshant, who is my co-EI Secretary. I have with us Professor Vipul Mathur. And we have our guest for today, that is Mr. Arindam. He's a CEO at SRL Diagnostics. He was a part of the class of 95 at IIM Calcutta. He's a business leader with more than 2 decades of cross-industry experience in a variety of sales, marketing, and operational roles. He's worked on some of the biggest names in the country, including Colgate, Pillsbury, Haagen-Dazs, Sterlite Tech, etc. He's now been entrusted to take SRL Diagnostics to its next phase of success. So we are very happy to have you here, sir. Good afternoon.
Thank you. I'm happy to be there. So I know you guys are the 56th batch. I was the 30th, but it doesn't seem that long. So it's always great to talk to people from IIM Calcutta. So, you know, you have been in Joka once, so a little bit of Joka stays with you right through life. So there are a whole lot of people from IIM Cal on this. Some of my colleagues are also from the same place. So I'm extremely happy to be here with you guys today.
All right. Thank you so much, sir. So let's just start off. Let's just deep dive into this. So first things first, how did your journey at Joka prepare you for the future? Or for something like this?
Well, that's a tough question. So let me just think aloud. So, those 2 years were momentous years, right? I mean, those are the formative years of your life. You guys are living it, so you know it better. So often, a few of the things that come to my mind is when I joined, you know, I didn't have work experience when I had joined IIM Cal. So I was passed out from Kharagpur. So I was a mechanical engineer from IIT Kharagpur, and then I joined. And honestly, those 4 years, and I don't know whether you guys are engineers or not, those 4 years just went by. We just had fun, and somehow 4 years just got by. I was just a rookie engineer, didn't really know much about life, just landed up at IIM Cal with less, to be very, very honest, at this stage, one can say that, looking back 26, 27 years, one can say, I didn't say that during my interview, but, obviously one can say that I really didn't know much about my career plans. I'm sure you get a lot more smarter than what we were 26, 27 years back, had no plans. I was just a rookie engineer, just landed up in IIM Cal. Honestly, 2 years hence, or a little less than 2 years hence, I had a lot of definition. It's not that I knew what I'll do today. Frankly, I was an engineer, and stroke of luck, now I lead the leading medical diagnostic company. So I'm not a doctor. I have 500 doctors in my organization, apart from the close to 4,000 paramedical staff. But never thought that will happen. But had a lot more definition in my life in those 2 years, I think. Fell in love with marketing. I mean, obviously, I studied both marketing and finance, took equal number of courses both. But it was very clear that I wanted to do marketing. So that's something that I fell in love with, and that still remains my second love. First love is handling a business, and more than handling business, actually handling people. That's what I do most of the time, managing people, and enjoy that. But marketing, brand still remains my first love, and definitely today something that I lean back on. That's something that I learned in those 2 years, learned to love it as well. When I passed out of the campus, those were different days. So lots of FMCG company used to be day one, and also I got through Colgate. I didn't get through Levers. I thought I'll get through Levers. I couldn't make it in the final round. So I got through Colgate, and I also got through Stanchard. At that point in time, Stanchard used to pick up quite a few kids. So I was very clear. So obviously the foreign bank was a lot more cushy, better profile, air-conditioned rooms. They also had some fantastic the management training program. Whereas Colgate, everyone said Colgate Levers, they'll grind you, they'll send you to back of the beyond, and sort of you learn it the hard way. But I was quite clear. And that's what the 2 years probably did for me, that I was very, very clear that, okay, I'll pick up Colgate because I want to learn marketing. And the only way you can learn is, supplement what you have learned in class by really what happens in the market. So that's one thing that happened. Definitely my peak from those 2 years. Second was obviously the peer group. The friends who obviously have reached, pretty much top of their own act wherever they are. And that's a fantastic peer group and network that one can lean on. And that's something that you sort of inherited from those 2 years in Joka. So that's definitely the second one. Third is dealing with unpredictability. So I don't know how the teaching patterns are. Maybe it's much tougher than what it was. But you know, all those surprise tests and middle of the night post dinner being called in for, you know, giving an open book test, sometimes crazy deadlines, multiple priorities, various professors asking for various things all at the same time. Those taught you a lot about life, because that's exactly what I do today. I mean, like at any point in time, there are 50 people asking 50 things. There's interruptions in terms of phone calls, emails, board members want something, teams want something, you know, customers want something at all points in time. So how do you really balance various priorities? So that's early flavor of that is something that I picked up in Joka as well. So I would say, yeah, mix of those three is what I sort of learned in those 2 years.
That's really good to know that, you know, that this is, I mean, right now we don't probably see whatever we are learning. We'll probably come around to it in a couple of years when we look back.
Sure.
So, yeah.
So, Arindam, the second thing we wanted to ask you was around what went through your head when the lockdown was announced. I know it's a very broad question, but some things would have gone through your head as soon as the lockdown was announced. Like, how does the future look to you?
Okay. Okay, so that's again another deep question. So, being in healthcare, while we couldn't have predicted a lockdown, but one was tracking the COVID-19 you know, prevalence. So from while November, December, hardly anyone was talking about, but by Jan, people in healthcare at least was talking about the fact that, you know, something is happening and it's spreading pretty fast. And that time it was more in Wuhan. So one knew the prevalence of the virus. And given that we have so many doctors, they speak to their counterparts. And so one knew something serious is coming. Did we or could we predict the lockdown? We couldn't predict the lockdown. No one could. But the lockdown on, I guess, what, 24th of March, when our Honorable Prime Minister announced the lockdown, it was in a way putting a stamp of seriousness, an official stamp of seriousness to the problem which was already there. So it is not that because of lockdown, suddenly the issue became serious, but it was more like a official stamp of seriousness on the same. So when one heard it, yes, for a country like India with more than 1.3 billion people, it is indeed a very brave and bold step. You know, like no one would have thought about that a country like India with so many states, so many people can actually get into a lockdown. I mean, at that point in time, no one knew it will go on for so long as well. So it was a bold step. And the first thing that went through my head was, first of all, how do I reorient myself at a personal level? Because life is suddenly different, a large part of your life and day get spent in work, get spent in office, get spent in travel. So I had to travel quite a bit. Almost every week I was traveling somewhere or the other. So first thing was, yes, one is to reorient oneself in a personal space. And second, the immediate part was that does one manage work? Because unlike many other industries, we are essential services. So while the lockdown was there, all my labs had to function, and they did. So I have more than 400 labs across the country. So the next was obviously doing a huddle with all my senior team that how do we make sure that my labs can be operational, even if not with 100% people, but with majority of the critical staff. How do they reach the lab? Do we need to provide for transportation? In some specific cases we did, even for people working in molecular testing, which does COVID testing, by the way. For those people, we had to, because they were working and they still are, last 60 days, I don't think they have taken a break. They're working all three shifts. So we have made sure that they get a accommodation close to the lab. So whole lot of on-ground things that we had to do pretty quickly. We had to dial up our training and retraining. We had to do a lot more communication during the time. So the first priority was, how does the lab and all the labs remain operational? And second was, how do we keep those people safe? Because the people's safety, and even to this date, obviously that remains my largest priority. So those were the two pretty much immediate thing that went through, that how do I reorient my entire workforce, because sadly we have not come to a stage or that kind of technology hasn't developed that our pathology lab can operate through Zoom or through, you know, online medium. So there's still large machines, it's like a factory. So the samples still have to go to a physical space, and those physical space have to remain operational. So that's, I think, what was going on in my head at that point in time.
Great. So yeah, good to have you in them here, and especially the fondness with which you spoke of your courses in marketing and finance. I'm sure there are lessons to be taken there, Diksha and and Isha. I hope you are paying attention.
I didn't mean that I didn't enjoy economics. So it still remains. And actually, my son, who's now completing class 11, he is in DP1. He does IB. So okay. He has decided that he will be doing his undergrad in economics. So just for your information.
Wonderful. Thank you. I mean, we economists just assume that everyone is interested in economics, and you're just also speaking about the modeling assumptions. I'm sure our chaps here at IIM Calcutta, they already have a very healthy distrust for any kinds of models. So I'm sure they are all prepared for this sort of scenario. Anyway, so speaking of this great work that you are doing at SRL, this has also been in some ways a great instance where the public and the private sector players have come in together so swiftly in order to tackle this this objective. How do you foresee the role of private players moving forward in terms of handling this crisis?
Sure. So talking about healthcare in India, public spending in healthcare is still very small. Is slightly less than 1% of GDP. If you look at overall healthcare, about 2/3 of spends is still in private healthcare and about 1/3 in government, which is drastically opposite of, say, any country. Say, for example, take UK, where 80% will be government and less than 20% will be in the private hands. So, by definition, a large part of healthcare today is in private hands. I'm not saying whether that's a good or a bad thing. If you really look at it from a broadly, not for just people like us, but overall India, because as you know, India is still a poor country and a large part of the population still don't get 2 square meals a day. It's extremely important that government increases their spends on healthcare and improves the overall infrastructure. The number of doctors we have in the country is a minuscule number compared to the population that we have. But saying that, today, role of private healthcare is paramount. With that fact that if you cannot handle a pandemic like COVID with purely government infrastructure, because unfortunately they are weak today. And government has various other priorities in our exchequer. When you do the maths, and I'm sure it's not an easy job when you're a finance minister, you have multiple priorities. Their priorities will be far higher than what priorities I have as a CEO of the company. So, they can only spend, or they have been only spent that much on healthcare, which I believe is still very low. So willy-nilly, private healthcare companies will have to do a lot more. COVID has also, if you talk about diagnostics, everyone reads about testing today. The last 60 days, every newspaper, every TV channel only talking about COVID. So while on one hand, as I said, that government has taken pretty bold steps in declaring lockdown pretty early on, and they're now trying to see how to unlock and get the economy back on shape. At one place, which is test done, we have lagged far behind. And that's what WHO has said, and everyone else is saying that we are not testing enough. Our testing rate per million population will be one of the lowest in across the world, at least amongst all the large countries. So with that in mind, of course, if you look at diagnostic players like us, it's been quite a journey. Our interaction and our association with government, especially from diagnostic side I can speak about, has been extremely high ever since beginning of March, when we were discussing with ICMR and various other bodies before they really approved private labs who can also do COVID test. So there were about 2 to 3 weeks of intense discussion that we were doing before the private labs got opened up. And even today, a lot of discussion is happening with even very, very senior people like Indu Bhushan, to ensure that, you know, whether diagnostic can also have a role in PMJ, Ayushman Bharat. So our constant dialogue and constant discussions are on, whether directly as a company or through various industry bodies that we are part of, whether it's FICCI, whether it's CII, whether it's NatHealth. So a lot more interaction obviously has happened. And yes, personally as SRL, obviously we are very proud that we could play our role right at the forefront. We were one of the few initial labs, private labs, which were approved by end of March to do COVID test. Initially, we started off doing in three of our labs, and we are in the process of expanding that. And so currently we do those tests in Bombay and Delhi, but we are in the process of opening more COVID labs in South, in East, in other parts of the country as well, to ensure that more people can be tested. So we have been pretty much there. And as I told you, our molecular biologist and our mol bio section has been working 24/7, literally 24/7 over the last 60 days. We have hired more people. You may be thinking about a lot of other industries which have different kind of issues. We actually had to get in more people in MolBio, a lot of more technicians, a lot more data entry operators to cope up with the load. I think we must have done more than, every day it keeps on going up, but as on the last count that I saw yesterday, we must have done more than 60,000 samples being tested by SRL, which is still a small fraction of overall India, and it's only going up. So we are pretty proud that we have been able to play the role, and we are constantly engaged with the various authorities. As you know, currently we are doing diagnostic tests for COVID using RT-PCR platform, which you may have heard about. The next stage will be once the herd immunity grows, or we think there's community transmission, government will probably come in with antibody testing to see whether we really have the so-called immunity passport or do we really have the antibodies. So that will require different kind of tests. So we are, our R&D department is already involved. They're doing the necessary validation, keeping ourselves ready, so that as and when the authorities open up that part, we'll also be ready as one of the first players to also start doing those tests as well.
So you've certainly raised very valid arguments about the testing. I mean, the first thing that, you know, we want to also have your opinion on is that we've been looking at the testing data, and of course, so surprised that India ranks on the lower side of it.
Right.
But in your opinion, are we sort of missing on any nuances? I mean, is there any other alternative parameter or variable that we should be looking at given the heterogeneity that we are struggled with here in India?
Sure. So no, that's a good question, and I can only give an opinion on it because I wouldn't have the perfect expertise to be able to give a final verdict. Yes, testing rates are low, but at the same time, fatality rate is also low. Mortality, if you see, is also low in the country. So should one test more? My view is clearly same as what WHO has said, that you need to do a lot more tests. Currently, I guess what is becoming an issue is the infrastructure. So if you really put yourself in the authorities' shoes or the public department shoes, they actually don't have that much of hospital beds. Between, so for a country like 1.3 of like India, the whole world will not have kits to test all of 1.3 billion people, say for example. Neither will have money. I mean, whoever pays for it doesn't matter, whether you and I pay for it or government pays for it. RT-PCR test is an expensive test. So I don't think even a country like India can afford testing that kind of a population, a billion population. So it's practically impossible. The whole world will not have that many kids. We also have infrastructure shortage in terms of the number of doctors, number of beds, number of ICU, number of ventilators. So authorities at that this point in time has been very restrictive in testing. They have their logic. I'm not coming in the defense of this. Obviously, my view is that you need to test more. But then again, I'm sure government has their own logic, and probably their logic is that their infrastructure is so frugal. If too many people fill up those infrastructure, they'll have problems. So they're trying to, at this point in time, only test those who are seriously symptomatic. So there is a lot of debate that goes on amongst experts that globally, a lot more people are actually asymptomatic who are positive. But at this stage, our authorities are primarily focusing on getting the symptomatic people tested because they have to do priority somewhere else. So that's what is happening today. Now, whether one can look at any other parameter, difficult to say, because globally the only tool that is available to know whether you have COVID-19 or not. Sadly, I mean, the confirmatory test is only RT-PCR globally. Even the antibody that I talked about is not really a confirmatory test. It tests whether you have developed antibodies, which actually happens when you have got infected. So technically, with the kind of virulence this virus has, and don't get scared, but technically all of us, there's a very high chance that all of us can get contracted. But the good news is, maybe none of us on this call, all of us are healthy young people, none of us will even know that we ever had the virus. Will not even show any symptoms. So that's what will happen 9 out of 10 times or 95 out of 100 times probably, and will develop antibodies. So the, what the antibody test will do later is whether you have developed antibodies. So are you safe to go back to workforce or not? But is there a different testing protocol? No. And beyond a point, you know, like you cannot keep on this lockdown forever, because it's always a question of if you keep this lockdown for longer time, more people will die of hunger in a country like India than that of COVID. So that's a balancing act is what the authorities are currently doing.
Great. So, I mean, sounds like, I mean, there are a couple of operational challenges that needs to be navigated through here. I mean, in your experience, have you found certain behavioral reluctance in terms of people willingness to get themselves tested, or even cost as a barrier in your experience at SRL?
Sure, sure. So one is, I guess, even before you get into those few issues, what lockdown has done is it has put severe restrictions on people to go out on the road. Second is all the OPD clinics have been shut. So because you can't just go to a lab and say, I need to get COVID tested. You have to go to a doctor first who will prescribe you. Given that OPD clinics in all the hospitals were shut, elective surgeries were shut down, there was no public transport, and there was a panic and scare phenomena. So people were not even venturing out. So, they would be doing their COVID test only there is a serious symptom. Otherwise, people preferred staying at home. Second is, you know, like, and which is unfortunate, in some parts of the country, we have also seen a little bit of stigma attached to people who are coming COVID positive. So sometimes in some community, they have even got ostracized. The whole family gets ostracized because a healthcare worker has come in positive while actually treating other people. So there's a little bit of panic and stigma that is still associated, and the only way to get over it is getting more facts on the table and getting people educated. Because as I keep telling my employees as well, it's extremely important that all of us stay safe, right? I mean, this is a pandemic. So we have to take care of ourselves. We have to take all the safety precautions, whether it's mask, whether it's using sanitizer, whether keeping ourselves those at a distance from other people. But we cannot live life with panic. So what happened is, and there's a fine line being safe and staying in panic. And I think some point in time, you also toppled. There's so much of information or misinformation that was coming up, especially in the initial days, a large part of the country went into panic mode. And that is a little bit of sensitization that is required, that someone coming positive is not an issue actually, because as I told you, the fatality rate is so low, less than 3% in India. So chances are that those other 97 people will be all right. I mean, and they'll actually be better off. So because if you have, you know, practically if you have got infected mildly once, you are better off than not getting infected. So take it from me. So if you have got mildly infected, you're actually better off because you have then developed antibodies. So chances of you getting infected later will be far, far lower. So those were there. So challenges were supply chain. Initially, there were lots of challenges on testing kits and PPEs, which has now got sorted out. So those initial challenges were always there. Then, of course, health is a state subject, and India is a complicated country. So many a times there's a center view, there's a state A view, state B view, state C view. And as many people, that many views. You know, it's almost like the millions of gods that we have in our country. So similarly, we have that many views on COVID as well. So each state has their own way of doing COVID testing. Sometimes they meet or does not meet the center's guidelines. So those are additional challenges that you have to navigate almost every other day.
And you also interestingly spoke about the R&D that's happening, especially at the molecular biology part. Do you think, I mean, it is worth to explore some alternative testing technologies? I mean, for instance, TrueNAT versus RT-PCR has been up mm-hmm. for a little while.
Right.
Do you think there are some advantages there?
Okay, so there are different testing methods available. So, of course, TrueNAT does that same test. The Puritans still believe that the pure blood RT-PCR is better, but then, you know, people always talk that about any new technology, to be honest. I'm not a doctor. So is TrueNAT good? Of course it's good. Is it better than current RT-PCR? Very difficult to say, but it does the same work. Then there is a company, Chitra in Kerala, who's also developing a technology called LAMP, as you must have heard about. People are saying can be a path breaker. My R&D is in touch with the founder of Chitra as well. We are trying to figure out whether the technology will work. If that works, that will be far cheaper than RT-PCR or TrueNAT, both of them. Then there are, of course, cartridge-based tests which are available, which are still RT-PCR, but happens in a with Cepheid cartridge in a platform called GeneXpert. That's an easy-to-do test, but then the cost becomes even higher. So we are evaluating multiple because finally it is a test of, you know, you're extracting RNA from the swabs, and then you are doing something called a reverse transcription. That's what RT stands for. You know, in real time you do that, and then the PCR is nothing but a polymerase-based chain reaction. So it replicates, you know, DNAs and tries to see versus a positive that you have for DNA by doing multiple chain reactions for a very short time, whether your sample that you have closely resembles a positive sample or not. So that's what it does. So globally, that is the well-known technology. LAMP can also work probably, and TrueNAT also works. But fundamentally, TrueNAT uses a different platform, but in terms of principle, not very different from RT-PCR.
I see. Great.
Okay, so I had a question here. As you mentioned in the beginning, that there is no clear consensus on how the virus even spreads, right? Now, given that we have limited...
Consensus on virus, how it spreads is there. However, what are the determinants of the virus? That is not known.
Yeah, so question around that actually. Say, we right now say that we have very limited testing capacity, right? And in this limited testing capacity, is it possible to pinpoint what is the root cause of the spread? Say, when there was lockdown, everyone was at their home, and there were limited services outside. Now, we know that the virus is spreading, the numbers are increasing, but what is the root cause of the spread? If we could tackle that, what is your idea around that, if you can address?
Yeah, I think that's, you have asked a very, very, very deep and important question. I'll give my thoughts, probably not an answer, because I don't have an answer how to. Let me tell you what happens when you test. When you test, you get to know at that point in time, at the specific time when the sample has been taken, and that's true for all tests, including all blood tests. At that point in time, what is the physiological condition within your body? That's all the test does. How much ever I want to know it, and all of us want to know it, a testing doesn't tell you the source, sadly. No testing will ever tell you. All the testing does is at that point in time, do you have that virus or not, is all that it say, and things can change in 15 days time. So that's the reason when you are a positive patient, after 5 days or 7 days, you are tested again, because there's something called virus shedding which happens. So it goes up and down. The virulence in your body also keeps going up and down. So does it, testing does not tell you what's the root cause or what's the source. As of now, like any other viral spread, okay, viruses can stay alive only within your body. What doctors are saying is human beings are the only proven carriers as of now. Okay, so not other species as of now. I mean, they haven't found anyone. So the source is we each other. So that's very clear. What is very, very clear is the source of the disease, if you ever get infected, will be another human being. Not anything else, because even if virus stays on any other surface, whether it's newspaper, whether it's metal, whether it's anything else, I mean, I'm sure you would have read it, how many hours our virus stays active there. The virulence goes down in no time if it goes on any other surface. So it's only within human body it stays alive and stays active. So the source is very clear. Source is another human being. So that's now, where has it come from? Has it come from China? Has it come from somewhere else? Has it come from Europe? Frankly, don't really know. But at this stage, even no point answering that question. It's already there in India. It's there in lakhs and lakhs of people. So that's already there. So only option today is testing as many people as possible, detect people who are positive from negative, who are positive, ensure that you contain them, you segregate them, make sure they are given the right kind of support that they can bounce back. And then at a community level, do a large scale antibody testing to understand state by state, what kind of immunity has been developed. Because since we are doing this test across India, the positivity rates, and while I'll not be able to tell you exact percentage, I'm not allowed to, but the positivity rates of each state is extremely different. So I know positivity of some states being 10 times or maybe 20 times of positivity in some other state. So it is very, very local. So the issue is not the same. I mean, the issue in a Bombay or a Delhi is not the same as what is in there in Jharkhand or what is there in Karnataka or what is there in Tamil Nadu. So it's very, very different. It's very local as of now.
So a question just in response to your reply before we move on to the next one. Sorry. My basic understanding here is, let's say when a person comes into the hospital and he has to be tested and he's tested positive for coronavirus, let's say, do they take an interview or do they talk to that person in order to understand what are the possible scenarios using which he could have contracted that particular disease? And like Vipul Mathur sir here has written a paper on, rather than having restrictive zones in terms of geography, opening up new kind of businesses. So Mathur sir can elaborate on this, where some particular businesses are more prone to coronavirus due to the social distancing part. And if we can know the root cause of why this person was contracted with coronavirus, we could pinpoint on that and it would help.
I think he's talking more about contact tracing.
Sure. So that question actually gets asked before the person gets tested. So it's not necessarily an interview after he comes positive. So every person, every patient whose sample comes, apart from a doctor's prescription, there's something called a form 44 which comes. So ICMR has laid down, based on their knowledge, 6 or 7 areas through which they feel someone can get contracted, whether coming in touch with a positive patient, whether going abroad in the last 14 days, XYZ. So that's a form that gets filled up. So, and every single form comes in and that gets uploaded on the ICMR's website. And NCD is actually seriously working on it. A lot of data scientists at NCD are working today to work out and do analytics based on that. They obviously haven't shared it with any of the private players yet. But every single test that has happened in India till date, every single test has a form attached to it. And that form gets uploaded onto the ICMR website before midnight the same day.
Makes sense.
I think that's very interesting. Moving on from that, in a recent interview, you talked about samples being collected from home, as well as mobile vans and drive-through being a significant part of the revenues in foreseeable future.
Yeah.
How do you plan to focus on this model, especially in the lockdown times?
Mm-hmm.
And just to follow up on that, on what are the lessons you've learned, right? Because it's a considerable shift from your current operating model. So right now, I think it would be a small part of your revenues, but it will considerably juggle now. So could you talk about that?
Yeah, sure. See, home collection, even pre-COVID, yeah, rightfully so, it's still a very, very small part of our business. But over the last 2 to 3 years, home collection, even pre-COVID, has seen an incredible growth. I mean, home collection has been growing upwards of 50-60% on a very small base, of course, every year. So home collection has been focused even earlier. Of course, I'll talk about what are we doing extra or more post-COVID. But home collection was growing, especially in cities like Bombay, Delhi, Bangalore, at a very, very fast clip. So we had ventured, and large labs like us had ventured into home collection earlier. So we have dedicated phlebotomists. There's a separate software where the home collection request gets recorded and slots are given. There's a centralized customer care group which checks in all the calls. We launched our SRL app, I guess about a couple of years back. It has more than 2 million downloads. So 90% of everyone who books SRL test on app calls for a home collection. So home collection was thriving. One of the hypotheses, and again, let me tell you again, this is a hypothesis, what you're talking about, that home collection will grow. Even I believe that's one of my hypotheses, but then hypothesis will have to be proven post-lockdown opening up that, what will change and what will not. And since you guys have studied marketing and you'll know, I mean, habits are very deep-rooted, right? The motives that people talk about or psychologists talk about motives gets hard-coded in us when we are still young kids. So many a times habits are very difficult to change. So I have also heard webinars. So I was hearing Arvind Singhal, who obviously is a doyen in retail industry, as you know. So his view is that, public memory is short. Everyone is so scared today. Come 2021, 31st March, you will see people's behavior will go back to normal. Everyone thinks that people will all work from home. I mean, I'll give you some quick statistics. I mean, everyone thinks, oh, my working will change and everyone will work from home. Yes, people who go to office will go. 8% of workforce in India, 8% goes to office. People who work in India, 8% of those goes to office. Most people who work in retail outlets, work in outside, work as courier boys. So that's real India. So we actually don't represent India. So sometimes we feel, oh, India will change and India will work from office. So sometimes those are sobering thoughts that large part of India actually don't have an option of going to an office. So they'll still go where they go. Their workplace is where it is. I mean, they will not be able to stay at home and do those work. But saying that, will home collection grow? I know I digressed a bit. Will home collection grow? My hypothesis is, yes, it will grow. So what we are doing is we are enhancing what we are doing already. So it's not that we are doing any new things. We are doing more of what we are doing already. So we are revamping our Flavor Thomas team. We are revamping our customer care group. We anyway upgrade our app every 6 months anyways. We are trying to see the UI of the app. Does it have to change? Can it handle additional load? Especially our home collection was primarily focused around top few cities. Do we need to aggressively pursue home collection in other cities as well? So those are the various areas that one is looking at to see that how to make, it will be a trend. And if it comes as a trend, how to make that trend a friend.
Isha, if I can just sort of come in. I mean, that's a great point you mentioned about home testing as and trying to aggressively target the other cities. Mm-hmm. Because currently, we're glad to have your opinion on it. There's a bit of a geographical divide in terms of where the testing lab capacity is available. The tier two cities do not have any kind of testing labs. Do you think that the home collection, et cetera, could help mitigate that sort of a divide?
Okay, so one needs to understand the industry, the testing industry, and say the hospital industry. Okay, the difference is, and especially if you talk of pathology, unlike a radiology, where a patient needs to go in. To do an X-ray, physically you have to go in and stand in front of X-ray, unless a mobile X-ray comes to your home. But an MRI, typically you have to go to an MRI machine. To a hospital, you have to go to a physical hospital. Labs actually does not really matter where the labs are seated. So what we do is a hub and spoke model. So I can pull in sample from pretty much every single corner. And on a real-time basis. So only impact that we had was because of lockdown, all kinds of intrastate and all flights got canceled, and they're still canceled in many places. But otherwise, you can pull in sample at any point in any place in India to any other place. So it doesn't impact that much. Is it good to have labs everywhere? Of course, it's good to have labs everywhere. But then when you are doing a test in 24 hours, chances are that if you are taking to another state, that 24 hours deadline will become 48 hours. So that's a difficulty, that instead of getting to know in a day, you will get to know in 2 days. But the samples do move in everywhere. And that's how you do unit level economics. That, because RT-PCR test is not like your routine blood test. Apart from the machine cost, the biggest cost is the kind of people that you put in. So obviously you need to put dedicated resources and molecular biologists, which obviously all comes at a cost. The expertise comes at a cost. It's easier to put in a machine in every state. But frankly, I'll not get, I mean, like I'm actually, I'll be the first private lab to put a RT-PCR lab in Jharkhand. We do a PPP model with Jharkhand, so I am in the process of putting something there. But my biggest issue is not putting the machine. Machine is the easiest part for me to put. I mean, as long as I release a PO, someone will give me a machine. Is actually getting a doctor there. So that becomes a much bigger issue. So even if the labs are everywhere else, you can still pull in sample. Home collection, yes, further. Within a city, even if you have a lab, everyone doesn't have to come to a lab. You can still go to people's home and pick up samples. So partly intra-city home collection helps. Inter-city or interstate, the hub and spoke model helps.
So coming to a very specific question, maybe for us, as in the batch of 2021, batch of 2022 who are coming to MBA programs right now, what advice would you have for students as to how to cope with the current pandemic's impact in their lives? How does it look forward to in terms of job scenario or any particular thing that you think we should focus on in the MBA curriculum? What are your thoughts on that?
Would you recommend them reading molecular biology is what he's asking, I think.
No. So I'm managing this company for the last close to 4 years. Honestly, even today, I don't know enough about molecular biology. So you can still do a very good job, even without knowing molecular biology. But I think the often abused and most used word is unprecedented. So let me use it once more. The COVID is unprecedented, right? I mean, none of us were prepared for it, from US president to students of IIM Calcutta. So you are not one. Everybody from the senior most leaders were not prepared. So take heart in the fact that you are not alone. The biggest of the experts were also not prepared, and you guys were also not prepared. So let's understand that it's an issue and it's a difficult
time. But the US president already has a job. It's the placements that will be affected for the Calcutta students.
No. I agree.
Because Mathura hits the nail on the head.
That's true. No, and it is very, very unsettling, and especially, but again, it's a relative context. So one, first of all, is it's accepting the fact. Accepting the fact that, yes, it is a difficult time, and will it impact and can it impact? It is probably already impacting, and partly it can also impact. So first of all, understanding the facts and being knowledgeable of the facts are important. But as you know, every cloud also has its silver lining. So once you know the facts, I mean, it depends on what you want to do with the facts. Because as they say, when there's an issue, the issue itself is not the real problem, which stresses us. It's how we react to the issue is what stresses us most of the time. So collect facts and then decide what you want to do with the facts. There are enough statistics, and statistics can be used in various ways, as you know, and depending on which way you want to use statistics, you can use statistics. So you can either get completely panicky and say that everything that you have done and hard work that you have done in 20 years of your life, everything has gone and there's no life left for you. So you can almost get into a despondency, because some of the data is so very stark. The other point is that use facts and say that, okay, what are the opportunities as well that it throws out? And then it will be important that talk to people, talk to mentors, talk to your seniors, those who, as you said, Professor, who already has a job. So talk to them, talk to people, try to talk to people from various sectors and see what they are feeling. So try to get some bit of advice. This will pass. It's not that the COVID will go away. COVID will not go away in the next 1 year, but the virulence will definitely go down. And even today, there are many other diseases for which there's no vaccine. Doesn't bother us, right? Doesn't really bother us. There are serious diseases which are available in the world across, which doesn't have vaccine. Vaccine will take a year. I don't think will happen in 2-3 months time. But hopefully I feel that virulence will go down and people will learn to live with COVID. With that in mind, probably we'll have to see what our company is doing and take some learning. There have been some companies who are also doing very well during this time. There are some companies who have been extremely nimble, right? So I have heard people like Tesla, Ford, GM, they have even made respirators instead of cars. So they have quickly manufactured respirators and sort of jumped in onto the bandwagon, and they could do that. A lot of perfumeries have done sanitizers because their, you know, factories can handle sanitizer. We are suddenly have become one of the largest manufacturer of PPE. We hardly had domestic PPE 60 days back. We are one of the largest manufacturer of PPE today. We probably will start exporting PPE soon. So, you know, there are various companies, a lot of MSMEs who have been extremely nimble. Question is, what is the learning for students of IIM Joka to say that, okay, how can I be nimble? Yes, you had set your eyes that, okay, this is the industry I'll go in, and maybe that particular segment or particular industry in the foreseeable next 12 months or 18 months doesn't look like very, very hopeful. So will you be nimble or not is a question that you have to ask yourself. I'm not telling you. I mean, you have to ask yourselves, and you're all adults, and you have to ask that, are there other opportunities which are available, and do they open up? So whether it's manufacturing, which can be is opening up in a big way. Domestic manufacturing is going in a big way. So is there an opportunity there? IT and communication can be a big opportunity with more and more social distancing and physical distancing. I mean, there can be parts of IT which can be. Healthcare in itself can be another huge area of opportunity which typically doesn't see recession. So there are some industries which are also thriving as well. Second thing is that also being real about it. Even if it means that your area of choice and you are very, very focused on that and you don't want to change your focus, and which is perfectly okay, maybe you have to wait out a bit. And by waiting out a bit means maybe waiting a quarter or two quarters. In our overall lifespan, and our life expectancy is only growing, and all of us are working much beyond even, you know, when we reach our 50, 60 and all, people still keep working beyond that. Our 2 quarters is nothing. At this point in time, maybe things life has come to an end, but it's not. Frankly, if the sector that you're completely focused on is getting deeply impacted, maybe it's a question of a quarter or 2 quarters and things will be much better at, and your starting point will be much better. Look at it other way as well. I mean, where you stand versus students in India and students across the globe, you're probably much better off. In some of the best of institutes, say in US, since we talked about US, probably, you know, you are in Ivy school in India, compare yourself with an Ivy school pass out in US, you are much better off, much, much better off. They have visa issues. They have huge economy issues. India will bounce back much faster. They have loan issues, much bigger loan than what someone in Indian institute will have to take. So frankly, you're much better off. So sometimes when you compare, you suddenly feel, oh, you know what? I'm not that worse off. You guys all know relative grading, right? So life is all about relative stuff here. So you are actually much better off than various other students across. So you should take heart in that as well.
Thank you, Arindam. Just the last question. So we've read that you're very fond of road trips. When do you think you'll be able to go for the next one? And just to add on, have you ever taken a road trip from Calcutta to Shillong?
Wow, no. The last question first. No, I haven't driven from Kolkata to Shillong. I haven't driven much eastern part of the country. Sadly, where I belong there, I mean, my hometown is Kolkata, but I've never driven. My parents never had a car. I never had a car. My first car was when I was in Bangalore, when I was working for General Mills. I have driven a lot in South India. I had a lot more time, to be honest. Today, this year, I just don't get time unless I have to take a break and go somewhere. As a brand manager, as an area sales manager, and also I had, I guess, a lot more time at that point in time. So across South India, I have driven a lot. I have not driven enough in North, done a bit. And given that international travel is off for some time, many of my driving vacation has been in various parts of the globe. So I wanted to, you know, drive down the garden route in South Africa. So I went there. So I had a few choice, one or two are still left. I still have to drive and chase Aurora Borealis. I still have to go to Australia and, you know, drive down the Gold Coast. I haven't done those two, but I have done a few others. But I guess the next few ones will be, I guess, in North India. So there's enough in the hills. Since I'm based in Gurgaon, I guess we have been already talking about it within the family that some point in time we must go. So I guess very, very soon, I guess. I mean, I can't say whether it's next month or the month after, but we'll do that. We'll have to take those precautions. How long a trip you can take, I don't know. A day trip is very easy because inside the car, you are quite safe. You can take food. But till the time, hotels are safe and eating options are safe outside. Maybe long trips will be a little further away.
Okay. Okay. Hey, Arindam, I would like to thank you for the current meeting with Bipul Mathur, sir, Isha. Thank you, Archit. And it's just been really amazing for us to hear your thoughts from very close because you have been on the forefront leading the SRL diagnostics path to the current situation. We, as the students, weren't really aware of the nuances that we talked about in the current meeting. And these are actually very positive to hear, kind of like a positive ray of hope amidst the unprecedented situation, let me say again. So let me just thank you there. And yeah.
Yeah, and hopefully see you soon at the campus. Hopefully this will all go away very soon and then you can have the road trip from Calcutta.
Yes, I hope so too. And it was lovely talking. I mean, I know it's almost an hour. I didn't realize that we almost spent an hour. I loved chatting up with all of you. I mean, thank you, Professor. Thank you, Isha.
Thank you.
Lovely talking to all of you.
Same here.
Thank you so much for your time, Arindam. Thank you,
everyone.
Yeah,
thank you.
Bye.
Bye, Arindam.